This is All India Radio. In the program Spotlight, now we bring you a discussion on Niti Aayog Sustainable Development Goals India Index 2020-21. The participants are Sanyukta Samadhar, Advisor, Sustainable Development Goals Niti Aayog, and Ruchika Chitravanshi, Journalist.
The third edition of the Sustainable Development Goal India Index and its dashboard has been released by the Niti Aayog today. This is developed in collaboration with UN in India, and this index measures the progress at the national and at the subnational level in India's journey towards meeting the global goals and targets. And it has been a successful advocacy tool to propagate messages like sustainability, resilience and partnership. Ms. Samadhar, can you tell us a little bit about how have the states performed, who are the top performers, and which are the states that are lagging? What are the key takeaways of this report that has been launched today?
Niti Aayog today launched the third edition of the SDG India Index. This has become the measuring tool for the SDGs for the entire country, particularly because Niti Aayog has the mandate to oversee the SDG implementation, monitoring, and the supervision for the entire country. So we began this journey in 2018, and since then, the SDG India Index has become the main fray for the assessing the progress of the states and the union territories. And I'm very happy to say here that over the last 3 years, we've expanded, we've refined the index, which began with just 62 indicators covering just 39 global targets across the 13 goals at that time, to the present edition, which covers all the 16 goals with an analysis of goal 17, which is partnerships, with 115 quantitative indicators. So the refinement has happened, the coverage has expanded, and also our statistical systems and the data coverage and periodicity has also improved over the years, with 80% of our indicators sourced from the periodicity line between the last 2 years, from 2019 onwards. So coming to the results, because I think that's the most important thing that people are waiting to hear. So we categorize states into four categories, with the aspirant being 0 to 49, performer being 50 to 64, front runner 65 to 99, and 100 being achiever. So definitely one of the best thing is that no state or union territory is in the red or the aspirant category. And the number of states which have increased in the front runner category is very heartening. In 2019, only 10 states belong to the front runner category, which is green, and 12 more states have joined this category, with Uttarakhand, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Mizoram, Punjab, Haryana, Tripura, Delhi, Lakshadweep, Andaman, Nicobar Islands, Jammu, Kashmir, and Ladakh. So these states were, in the last year, they were in the yellow category of performer, and now they have gone to the front runner category. Needless to say, the top five states are, congratulations to the top five states. Kerala retains its position at the top category. Himachal Pradesh and Tamil Nadu have tied at the second rank. Andhra Pradesh, Goa, Karnataka, Uttarakhand, they have moved up their ranks and they've gone to the fourth rank, followed by Sikkim and Maharashtra. Definitely the states which need to do a lot more, let me say Chhattisgarh, Nagaland, Orissa, Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya, Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, Assam, Jharkhand, and obviously Bihar, which again remains at a score of 52, which is the lowest as of now. But apart from the movement of the states and the progress which the states have shown, basically all states have improved in their scores. Some may not have improved their ranks, but it's heartening to know that all states have improved their scores if you see the report. What is interesting is at the national level, what is it that we see? Because your question was exactly also as to where do we see India? So definitely there has been a progress from 2019 to 2021 in terms of 6 points. There's been an increase from a score of 60 to 66 in 2021. And this is particularly steered by the tremendous amount of progress that we see in Goal 6, which is clean water and sanitation, and Goal 7, which is affordable and clean energy. Definitely, logically, this is a push. This is steered by the amazing amount of progress in not only the Jal Jeevan mission, the Swachh Bharat mission, but also in the area of energy by the entire program of Saubhagya, household electrification, and on sustainable urban management. So I think these areas have shown progress. This particular tool also shows us as what are the areas of our weakness, which require a lot more focus, not only at the level of the states, but at the level of the center, and basically a cumulative effort. So this is largely goal 2, which is the nutrition zero hunger, largely driven by the levels of stunting and wasting among children, anemia among women. So these are some of the critical elements which go into making the zero hunger the goal 2. And also gender equality, which is goal 5. So we see that these two particular areas are still in the red category, which is the aspirant level, where the scores are less than 49. And these two areas, which the entire country knows, that these have to be worked upon, and not only by the government, because these two particular areas, they take a whole lot of effort from the entire society, from require a whole of society approach and synergies across departments and governments in order to show remarkable progress in the coming year.
Definitely, Kerala, Himachal and Tamil Nadu have retained their top positions, and you've also told us about areas where we are still not performing very well. Now, two of these things that you mentioned, the nutrition, zero hunger and the gender equality thing, can you share with us, if you've got a score sheet in front of you, which are the states which are performing particularly at a lower level and which are the states which are relatively better? And what are the kind of interventions it will take for India to achieve progress on these two goals? These are challenges that have been further aggravated by the pandemic, don't you think?
Yes, Ruchika, you're right. And that is why we see that goal 2 and goal 5 still remain in a red zone, which is an area of concern. So let me focus on the zero hunger part. In our entire framework of SDGs, what actually goes into zero hunger is largely what is the gross value added in agriculture per worker. Then adolescents who are anemic, again, children, stunted children, underweight, pregnant women who are anemic, and the agricultural productivity. With these components, what we see is the top performers in this are definitely Kerala, Goa, Punjab, Mizoram, Sikkim, and Arunachal Pradesh, who are in the front runner category. But the cause of concern is definitely the states who are in the aspirant category. 11 states, in fact, are rated in that score of 0 to 49, which is the aspirant category, with Jharkhand being at the number of 19, which is the lowest. Bihar, again, 31, second lowest. Chhattisgarh, 37. And Meghalaya, 37. I could tell you that the last four states, if we see in that order from the last, would be Jharkhand, Bihar, Chhattisgarh, Meghalaya, Assam. So these are some of the states which require a lot more focus, particularly in these areas of women and children who are suffering from anemia, underweight issues, stunting and wasting. And definitely, the pandemic has, so interventions definitely are the kind of interventions that have come up with in terms of the National Food Security Act and the additional food grain which has been allocated and the additional money which has been allocated in terms of direct benefit transfer. These are some of the key interventions which will show some impact in the next year itself. Now moving over to gender equality, which is goal 5. This has been a traditional area of concern since 2018 and has always been the goal which has always fared in the red category and has been a cause of concern for every stakeholder here. What I would like to say here is that the goal 5 talks about women's participation in the economy, the pay structures, the equality, the gender parity in pay, women's participation in the political arena, and also the kind of security and safe environment that women have. So some of the indicators which crucially go into goal 5 is women's control over operational land holdings, then things like crime and control over family planning, women's participation in the legislative assemblies and in managerial positions in companies, rate of crimes against women, again, the gender differences in the male-female salary gaps and labor force participation rate. So what we have seen here is, although there has been an improvement from last year in terms of the scores rising from 42 to 48 in goal 5, however, it requires a lot to be done. And some of the states who are doing well in goal 5, and none of them are front runners, none of them are in the green category though. Some of the states are in the performer category, in the yellow category. Chhattisgarh on top, Kerala, Himachal Pradesh, Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh on the top 5. And however, the states which are right at the bottom here would be Assam, Arunachal Pradesh, Tripura and Rajasthan. So these are some of the critical states which are, again, at a very low score, beginning from 25 to 39, if I may give you just the range of scores that the lowest states have. So amongst the various states of India, there's a huge gap, but it requires a collective effort, and not only it requires policy effort and more so behavioral and social effort in terms of improving the position, not only in the political arena, but also in the economic, financial and the health arena. So these were the critical concerns in Goal 2 and in Goal 5.
One of the things that NITI Aayog, this whole dashboard and the India Index does is it encourages an evidence-based policy making. Now, I would like you to talk a little bit about how states can have some sort of an interstate learning. What can they learn from each other? And is that platform also being provided by NITI Aayog? What kind of policy interventions are you suggesting based on the findings of this index?
This is just a beginning. When we come out with the index and what it helps in terms of doing it, it also kind of puts into place what are the critical areas of each state, what are the things that are working in some states which other states could learn. It actually provides a very beautiful arena for peer learning and to see what are the good practices which are working in, let's say, nutrition in the southern part of India, which could be replicated or customized in the northern states of India. So what we do with this index is it's just not the end of the process. It's in fact the beginning of the process, and it entails a lot of engagement. So I have to tell you this, that in the last 1 year, we have our team, we have visited around 12 states immediately after the lockdown opened last year, from September till April this year. So what we do is we personally engage as a team, we engage with the state governments, and we conduct a two-day workshop in each of these states. And that is where we try to come up with dedicated and customized reform action plan, reform interventions, which the state could use in order to plug those gaps. Now, these reforms could be very simple things like plugging the HR issue or some procurement issue or some simple legislation, some simple rules which could be kind of just framed by the state government. So these are the learnings, and these reform action plans is something that we pick up from our visits and from our engagement with the different states, where we understand that, where we try to understand as to how things are addressed in a particular region. Let's say how the problem of schools at a time of pandemic was being addressed in Gujarat. That became a learning for how some of the schools could manage in Uttar Pradesh. So some of these cross-learnings are very interesting, and this is what we take to the states. But we also work extensively and intensively with the state governments in order to prepare the reform action plans based on the diagnostics that come out from this entire gamut of data we are able to generate through the SDG India Index. So this is one of these highest forms of evidence-based policy making, where we bring in the evidence, we show it to the state governments, and from there we try to devise these policy interventions, these policy tweaks, which we work along with the state governments, and then it's obviously up to the state governments to kind of own it and then kind of implement it.
Do you think that health is going to get much, much bigger space in the Sustainable Development Goals, and overall, which direction do you see this evolving in the coming year?
The goal 3, which deals with good health and well-being, that has definitely become the focus of the entire country. Let me just say, not only the country, but the entire world, given in the last 2 years. A lot of focus has gone into it. The energies of the entire state has gone into it, let me say. Not only the finances, the energies. But again, in the SDG framework, the goal of good health is marked by certain established things which are again globally accepted, and they are part of the UN resolution, which deal with a whole gamut of things ranging from maternal and child health to per capita expenditure on health, and again things like communicable, non-communicable diseases, and the entire health infrastructure. So it's a very holistic kind of and very comprehensive goal which covers the different ranges of health, not only the health inputs, the health infrastructure, but also the health related outcomes. With the kind of parameters that are incorporated in Goal 3, there has been a remarkable improvement from 2019 to 2020, which is 61 to 74. That's a remarkable improvement. I believe that with the current focus on the health systems, this will continue to improve, because now the entire machinery is garnered towards improving the system, the health infrastructure, the health outcomes because of the pandemic.
Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts today.
Thank you so much, Ruchika. I would really request our audience to not only read the report, which is on our NITI Aayog website, but also to definitely visit our SDG India Index dashboard to have a feel of it. The entire data, it's very transparent. All data, all indicators, everything is in the public domain.
You were listening to a discussion on NITI Aayog Sustainable Development Goals India Index 2020-21. The participants were Sanyukta Samadar, Advisor Sustainable Development Goals, NITI Aayog, and Ruchika Chitravanshi, Journalist. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio.